This episode of Revolutionary Cultures features a lecture and a Q&A with Dr. Paul Oquist Kelly. The programme was recorded in the run-up to the US presidential elections in 2020 and is being released as part of the launch of the Irish chapter of the Network in Defence of Humanity. And this particular episode is also dedicated to Paul and Paul's life and to his living legacy, given the very sad news as this episode was being put together of Paul's passing. And Paul's legacy, via the book that he discusses in this episode, Equilibra, is very much a living one. So this whole episode is dedicated to Paul, to his family and his comrades in Nicaragua. One of the many remarkable and distinctive things about Equilibra as a book and as a project, as a distillation of Paul's whole life and work and his efforts to transform the world and to construct a more equitable and just world for everyone, that Equilibra is very much a template for doing so. The book cuts across layers of habituated, hegemonic thinking, hardwired thinking within capitalism and its global apparatus today, in terms of imperialism and its proprietorship over this planet. And the book is a really necessary and really urgent set of critiques of the wrong kind of thinking, as well as a very helpful, hospitable opening up of pathways to an alternative dispensation for this planet and the people who live on it. And one thing that comes across in the interview itself is that Paul talks about life being a privilege, being a gift, but also being a responsibility. That we have an obligation to one another and to this planet. And Paul's whole life and work is an example of that responsibility. One other thing that will come across in the discussion that we have is that Paul rightly talks very warmly and very favorably about Nicaragua. And he says that being in Nicaragua made this book possible. And Paul's work for the Sandinista Front is really exemplary in its commitment, its internationalism. And he talks so movingly and warmly about what Nicaragua means to him, his home, effectively, politically, literally. And part of that centrality of Nicaragua to Paul and to this world vision, this planetary vision that's made possible by Equilibra, is that Nicaragua is itself on a fault line in terms of geopolitics. It remains as it has been all the way through the Monroe Doctrine and the rise of US imperialism to begin with. It remains on the front line in the struggle against imperialism. And it's also a very particular kind of fault line when it comes to climate crisis. Nicaragua, like a number of other places on that crucial fault line across this planet, are going to feel the effects of the climate disaster much more acutely than elsewhere in the world. And Paul's whole internationalist vision is also very locally, nationally grounded in the Sandinista movement and in Sandinista egalitarianism and activism. So the lecture and the Q&A will deal with imperialism, this new Cold War, which Paul saw as happening regardless of whether Trump or Biden won, that Cold War was already in place. And his book is a really searing critique of that imperial hegemony that the US seeks to impose across the entire planet. It's also a very energetic call to arms. And one of the things both in the book and in the discussion in this episode is that Paul, despite the darkening of the times that we live in, Paul retains a sense of the power of mass movements, that history is there to be fought over. Its logic is not just predetermined, and that we can change history. So there's also, in addition to the searing critique that Equilibra offers of capitalist alienation and imperialism, there is a vision of hope and a sense that with young people taking up the torch, there is that possibility of change, that capitalism isn't one and the same thing as reality, that capitalism isn't one and the same thing as this entire planet, that alternatives are available. And one other thing about the book that I would encourage everybody to read, which itself has the imprint of the Sandinista movement upon it, is that the book is participatory. In other words, the book is actually quite open-ended. You'll find when you read it that Paul's very intelligent and very sharp vision is there, but there's also an invitation for everybody else to contribute to the book and to ongoing editions of the book. So it's actually intended as a kind of exchange. And I was really privileged to be able to have an exchange with Paul and to discuss his book with him. So Paul, this book is a great testament to your whole life, and it remains part of your very palpable legacy on this plane. To you and to your family and to your comrades, thank you so very much. Muchas gracias, compañero.
One of the things about your book is this need to think differently and to stop doing the same things over and over again. In the book itself, you list 9 alienations, and perhaps we could talk a bit about what those are, given that I suppose the ultimate alienation would be something that the Western world seems to experience in particular, and that's this sense that it's easier, as thinkers like Frederick Jemison or Slavoj Žižek have argued, it's easier for Western capitalism to imagine the end of the world, the end of the planet, than it is to imagine the end of capitalism. That's how deep and thorough that ultimate alienation is. Could you perhaps talk a bit about those alienations and how we go about resisting them?
Very good, very good. Let's start then by putting them on the table, mm-hmm. by putting the nine alienations on the table. This is the book, Equilibra, that Professor Kelly mentioned. And the little section on nine alienations begins, hegemonic culture is separated from nature through nine alienations that profoundly influence our psychology and reinforce actions and processes tending towards extinction. I'm going to read them, then we can go back and analyze them as Professor Kelly requests. The first alienation is to think that only the eternal is valuable and escape transient reality by creating eternity in thought, devaluating now, eternalism. The second evaluation is to believe that humans are not dependent on nature, but rather outside of nature, or even somehow above nature. That is supernaturalism. The third alienation is to posit humans as the masters of all nature, which exists to serve us, and degradation as an inevitable cost of progress. That is developmentalism. The fourth alienation is to place individual, group, or national consciousness or interest before our and other species' survival, which is ultra-individualism. This is also linked to another alienation that's even deeper, and that is, it used to be thought that the Earth was the center of the universe. That was debunked some 500 years ago, very thoroughly. But many, many people still think that human beings are the center of the universe, and the entire universe revolves around us. And this ultra-individualism brings it down even to individuals, that the whole universe revolves around the interests of a given individual or group or national consciousness. A fifth alienation is to prioritize short-term marginal gains above long-term catastrophic losses, even knowing the consequences. I want to read that again. A fifth alienation is to prioritize short-term marginal gains above long-term catastrophic losses, even knowing the consequences. Immediatism. We'll come back to this. Immediatism in a moment. The sixth alienation is to think that endless, limitless, mindless growth of production, consumption, and capital accumulation can occur on a planet with limited, degraded resources. And that alienation that is taking us towards extinction is called capitalism. Endless, limitless, mindless capital accumulation can occur on a planet with limited, degraded resources, capitalism. A seventh alienation, part of capitalism, is to prioritize financial systems above life support systems. This is financialism. Those systems that are being prioritized above all are commodity, equity, and derivative markets, which are almost worshipped in terms of the central role they play in neoliberal thought. An eighth alienation is to put all faith in science and technology to replace or compensate for damages we cause to ecosystems and the environmental disequilibria. This is scientificism. This is a messianism, if you will. The ninth alienation is fatalism, with two variants, providentialism and nihilism. one resigned and passive, the traditional providentialism, and the other negative, obstructive, and prone to violence, the nihilism, in which instead of looking for positive solutions, things spiral into negativism and obstruction and violence. We said we were to come back to this fifth alienation is to prioritize short-term marginal gains above long-term catastrophic losses, even knowing the immediate consequences, this immediatism. And this actually is what our hegemonic economic and political system is based on. Its basis is short-term marginal gains above long-term catastrophic losses, knowing the consequences, knowing full well the consequences. And that's our whole economy is working on the basis of the short-term gains. The corporate world works on the basis of the quarterly earnings report and the reaction of the stock market to the quarterly earnings report. And great homage is made to having a profit in that in the very short term, and long-term consequences are thrown to the wind. And the politics also is short term. It's the next November the 3rd in the United States at this point of time, and in other countries too. They're up to the next election. It's very rare to see any long-term planning. The only long-term planning that exists everywhere that I know of is for electricity. You have 20, 30-year planning of the electrical grids, because to invest in a hydroelectric dam or major transmission grids in most places in the world takes a very, very long time. Except Nicaragua, I might mention, that has gone from 54% coverage of households to 97% since 2007. Half of Nicaraguan households, roughly, didn't have electricity in 2007, and now practically everyone has it. And we're getting down into the very, very marginal cases that are being covered in with standalone systems. I also might mention that Nicaragua has gone from 26% renewable energy in 2007 to 77% last year, and we're on our way to 90% in terms of renewable energy. And that, of course, is not only a contribution to a reduction in greenhouse gases in the world, Nicaragua's contribution, it's also a reduction of the import of fossil fuels, which has a tremendous macroeconomic impact on our accounts. So it's a very positive element. But this long-term planning apart from energy, maybe the Chinese who think 50 years ahead, or who send people out to study so that in 20, 30 years, you can have something in 20, 30 years, even 50 years. They signed with the UK a 50-year deal on Hong Kong, and with the Portuguese, 50-year deal on Macau. That doesn't tend to happen these days. One of the arguments in Equilibra is that it's that from the very origins of our predecessors, their predecessors began, the pre-humanoids began to transform nature more and more effectively, to make tools out of nature, to transform nature more effectively, to find forms of heat and energy like fire. And then we come into the human beings and we have our Paleolithic, Mesolithic, Neolithic advances and transformation of nature, and we reach this point where we can have metals, so we have the Copper Age morphing into the Bronze Age and into the Iron Age, leading up to the civilizations that had a tremendous capacity through food storage, through water management, to produce food, transforming nature through agricultural techniques, through water works, became part of irrigation systems in these river valleys, the Nile River Valley and the Euphrates River Valley, in the Indus and the Yangtze River Valleys, where civilization first took hold. And so this transforming of nature then accelerates with capitalism and with the tremendous advances of science and technology, in which we have enormous capacity to influence nature. But that reaches a point where there's an inflection, and it becomes negative. And the greatest human scientific achievements are doubtful in terms of their benefit for us. For example, the splitting of the atom, the harnessing of the atom, what a tremendous scientific achievement. I think that arguably it would be one of the two greatest scientific achievements in history. The other would be the decoding of the double helix DNA, the code of life. Tremendous scientific advance. But the splitting of the atom in 1939, by 1949, it's been weaponized and used. And now there's 4,000 operational nuclear warheads laying around the world that if they're used, it will destroy humanity. There's no doubt that civilization as we know it and humanity will face extinction if these 4,000 nuclear warheads are used in a nuclear interchange. So the transforming of nature has become negative, but we have an enormous path dependency in transforming nature because that has been our success formula. So it's kind of like IBM, that had its success formula in the mainframes, and along come the personal computers, and it's hard for them to relate to that because their success has always been in mainframes. And so they get caught in the lurch that they get become obsolete or waylaid for a while they bounce back. Anyway, it says here in the book at one point that it's easier for us to continue transforming nature than to transform ourselves. And what do we mean by transforming ourselves? Coming to terms with these alienations. Coming to terms to accepting short-term gains that produce catastrophic losses, not just losses, catastrophic losses in the long term, and knowing full well those consequences and not acting upon that. This is where we get into the final part of Equilibria, which has to do with the ethics of this. And that becomes immoral. If you know that you are damaging the future of humanity and you continue to do it, then it's kind of like Greta in the United Nations, right? Where she told the assembled people in the United Nations, I'm sure you don't understand the consequences of your inaction. I'm sure you don't understand that. Because if you understood that, you would be evil. And I hate to think of you as evil. So I will suppose that you don't understand the consequences of your inaction. So this is a very, very fundamental point that we have this alienation of past dependency to continue with these short-term marginal gains that create long-term catastrophic losses. And capitalism, endless, limitless, mindless capital accumulation. No limit whatsoever. And it becomes more and more astounding. We had the 1% phenomenon before the pandemic. And then all of a sudden you see one headline that Jeff Bezos made $29 billion in 4 months, while at the same time, 49 million U.S. workers filed for unemployment insurance. If we had the 1% before, with Jeff Bezos, just Jeff Bezos, getting $29 billion in 4 months, and 49 million workers going into unemployment, what does that do to the rampant, extreme inequality that is going to destabilize our society also? It will become another threat, the degree of instability that will be derived out of that. Now, just yesterday, I saw another thing that he had made $14 billion in one day. So he just keeps making Guinness Book of Records in capitalist gluttony. And the system not only tolerates that, the system stimulates that, protects it. Then we have this alienation of putting all faith in science and technology. And it's very common. Oh, it doesn't matter. We'll screw up the world, but the scientists will find some way out. There'll be some technological fix that will save us in the end of the day. And then there's an extreme version of that that they're trying to monetize right now as part of financialization of everything. And that is that the way for humans to survive is to escape to Mars or a moon of Jupiter. These people think that it's easier to set up a human colony on Mars or on a moon of Jupiter than to fix the planet, than to fix our economic, social, and political wreck. They think it's easier than to do that, which is a very strong recognition by part of a certain sector of capitalism of how bad things are and what they have created. The fatalism, of course, is fatal because you do nothing. And one way or another, you're doing nothing positive. And that's just business as usual, just float along. And that's very common too in our lives and in different organizations that happens. Now, all of this is daunting enough as a challenge for us, but the hegemonic culture, the hegemonic economic and political system actively works to maintain these alienations in place. It actively works to maintain endless, limitless, mindless growth. But the U.S. has a policy of full spectrum dominance. And the measures that it uses to enforce that are a toolkit that came out of neocolonialism. And a lot of the neocolonial toolkit came out of the treatment of the United States of Central America and Latin America. And we particularly of Nicaragua, of the types of aggression that Nicaragua has suffered since the 1850s and 1909 and 1912 and 1928 and the Somoza dictatorship and the Contra War. It's incredible how the United States has been obsessed with controlling Nicaragua. And now it applies its preferred arm, which are the coercive, unilateral, illegal measures. All of these unilateral, coercive measures are illegal. All of them. The whole regime is illegal. So you have you have the only legal sanctions, the only thing that should be called sanction also, are those approved by the United Nations Security Council. With an international law, anything else is illegal. So the United States, the United Kingdom, the European Union, Canada, and as of last week, for reasons I don't understand, Switzerland wanted to join the gang of vigilantes trying to impose their will on everyone else. But this has all of the trappings of the imperial mentality. Feeling superior to everyone else. You feel morally superior so that you can sit in judgment of the rest of the world. That is a big leap. You are superior and you can judge the rest of the world. You can be police, prosecutor, judge, and jailer for the rest of the world with these illegal, coercive measures that you are pulling out. Actually, it becomes surrealistic because, you know, these are waged against countries like Iran, Venezuela, Cuba, Nicaragua. They're applied to organizations like the PDVSA Oil Company or the Nicaraguan police. By innocent. Coercive measures against the police for protecting the population at the time of a coup attempt, and in which the police saved the constitutional order and protected the population, and now they're subject to these coercive unilateral measures. So when they're applied, they're a violation of the civil rights of all of these people, of all of these organizations, and of all of these countries, because they're applied by administrative edict. In the United States, there's an office called UFAC in the U.S. Treasury, and it's the UFAC which applies the coercive measures. So they're applied administratively, and there's no judicial recourse. This is really draconian. This is really Orwellian. This is Big Brother in full action, that they can point to you and say, okay, you're out. And in this Majitsky type of thing to individuals, it's called the civil death, because they not only apply this to the individual in the concern, the U.S. claims extraterritoriality. The U.S. law or U.S. edicts or U.S. administrative actions are valid everywhere else in the world. To make this more acute, to make this more aggravated, the U.S. does not accept international law in its jurisdiction. To it, it pretends that U.S. actions are valid throughout the entire world, but that the international law is not valid within the United States. If that is not the definition of the mentality of Rome, I don't know what is. That is Mare Nostrum. That is in terms of the entire world, that the world is their oyster in terms of being able to apply this. Then it even gets worse, because third parties are criminalized for not accepting, for not following the illegal measures of the country in question. And they're criminalized, accused of not following these policies. Now this has a huge effect because of another thing that's one of the prime instruments of the sixth stage of imperialism that are analyzed in volume 2 of Equilibra, and that is the dictatorship of the banking system. The United States controls the SWIFT transfer system, and the entire capitalist world and beyond the capitalist world uses the SWIFT banking system for interbank transfers. And then we have the dominance of the unholy dollar. And so you combine the dominance of the dollar and the dollar touching base in the United States with the SWIFT transfer system, and it is extremely powerful more powerful than the actions that are undertaken themselves, because the bankers fear, dread being excluded from SWIFT. It would be like they would be outcast from the guild in the Middle Ages, so they would not be able to work if you're outside of the pale of the guild. And so the bankers tend to apply the measures more strictly than the letter of the fictitious U.S. measures. So it gets bad. As if this wasn't enough, it's even worse. It even gets worse. Can you believe it? It gets worse than this. And that is that people are killed also by administrative edicts. So in Yemen, in Iraq, in the Sinai, and in other regions of the world, in North Africa, a drone identifies a house, and they say a high-value target is in that house or in that vehicle. And then authorization is given by administrative edict for extrajudicial killing. So international law is completely lost, because even the right to life, even the right to life is subject to these administrative edicts without judicial recourse. And then other lives are taken along with it also. So it's called collateral damage. But collateral damage is someone's sister, it's someone's mother, especially when they mistake one of these gatherings and they blow it up in Afghanistan. And it turns out to be a wedding party, which has happened more than once, as you all will recall. But these are just mistakes that are inevitable and part of the collateral damage, with no responsibility for this whatsoever. And the United States, of course, did not accept the Treaty of Rome, the Statute of Rome, and the International Court of Criminal Justice, precisely because they feared that U.S. military personnel could be tried there for crimes against humanity of the type that we're mentioning now. Now, it's argued in the volume 2 of Equity, which will be out, will be finished by the end of this year and out this year, that just as bad as that sad reality is the fact that the world accepts this. That there's not a mass movement against these forms of imperial domination that have been put together and which are onerous and which are widespread. The illegal measures have been applied to 39 countries. These 39 countries have 2 billion people represented in them. Of course, there's a cheat there too, because you have China in there. So that helps to get the 2 billion quite a bit. It almost puts it over. You have China, you have Russian Federation. So you have some countries with good sized populations. But China is in the sight now, because we're beginning the Second Cold War. And the Second Cold War is already a reality. It's incipient, but it's a reality, and it is a go. And no matter who wins the U.S. election, the Second Cold War will continue. If you would bear with me, I would like to do another little parenthesis here, Aaron, and analyze why the United States needs so badly this second Cold War.
Please do, yeah.
The United States is a very complex country that has multiple layers of contradictions. It has multiple layers of contradictions. And power is highly concentrated, but in largely invisible forms. I would like to make some quotes here from the person to whom Equilibre is dedicated, this Father Miguel Descoto of Brockman, the Foreign Minister of Peace and Dignity of Nicaragua. Father Descoto wrote, "These wars of aggression and occupation are led by the United States, the European countries, and others of the so-called First World against the rest of the inhabitants of the Earth, who are given the status of inferior beings without the right to peace and a dignified life." Father Descoto goes on, "States rich in ethical principles and or natural resources which do not share the empire's pretensions, such as Iraq, Iran, Libya, Venezuela, Cuba, Bolivia, Syria, Nicaragua, and many others, are always in Washington's genocidal sights." Then Father Miguel, following Eisenhower, identified the power center of the empire. "The only thing," and here I quote him, "the United States represents is the interest of its own military industrial complex, as President Dwight Eisenhower said, who must have known something about it." I have a personal history with this. I was an honor student in Los Angeles, California high school system. And the honor students were given the right to have one university course. So these honor students were gonna go on to university to see what university was like. So I was an honor student taking a course at UCLA in January 1961, and there was a commencement exercise. So I went to the commencement exercise, and that's where Dwight D. Eisenhower made his famous military-industrial complex speech. He made an allusion to it on television in his farewell address, but the in-depth speech in which he states that this is a huge threat to U.S. democracy, he posits it as a threat to U.S. democracy. He says, "Before the Second World War, there was no standing army, and there was no big military industrial complex producing goods for war. But that had changed, and it was a threat to democracy." Equilibria describes the updated center of power as the military, police, intelligence, industrial, and financial complex, aka the deep state, which is more powerful than ever. More powerful than ever. The United States is a country with many contradictions and conflicts, as has been shown even in recent weeks. You can see it on the street. You can see it in Portland, Oregon, as we speak, and in Chicago and in other places. And it is difficult to have a united country without a common external enemy. The United States needs a common external enemy to try to pull together a country with so many unaddressed contradictions and conflicts. In the Second World War, it was fascism, very clearly. After that, communism was erected and demonized completely as the unifying force in the United States, the common enemy. After the demise of the Soviet Union and a short period in which there was a problem of no enemy, terrorism was edified as the enemy. And now that's begun to wear very thin too, that terrorism would be the big enemy. I once accompanied Aaron, Father Descoto, for a meeting with President Assad in Damascus, when he was President of the General Assembly of the United Nations. And Assad said something that stuck in my mind always, and it was, he says, U.S. military policy and foreign policy is like Hollywood movies. There's good guys and bad guys. And the bad guys have to be really, really bad. They have to be demonized. So they're demonized. And then Assad said, but have you ever noticed that these good guys kill a lot of people doing their good. And I think that that's quite apt when you look at Syria itself. His depiction could be well replied to his own country. Now we see the construction of an enemy. The construction of an enemy for on multiple counts to make this enemy a real demon. Not only to construct an enemy and to demonize this enemy. And that's one of two reasons why the United States needs an enemy. Its internal contradictions and conflicts. The second reason is that the military budget plus the budget of the 17 intelligence agencies. That's why it's no longer just a military-industrial conflict. It's the military police, like we're saying with the illegal coercive measures, which they turn into the world's policemen. Intelligence, which becomes so much more important with the covert operations and the use of information for the purpose of domination. And of course the financial sector along with the industrial sector, which has become much, much more important. And I think that that importance could be seen in the percentage of the total profits of corporations. Just before the 2007-2009 crisis, that had reached a point, it almost explains the crisis. In the 1980s, the financial services received 8% of the profits of all the corporations in the world, which one could say would be a reasonable price for their services of financial intermediation and risk management. By 2007, it had reached 40%. They were receiving 40%. They were sucking funds out of all of the sectors. How do they do that? Derivatives. The derivatives of all types and market-based securities and all of this. And then after the crisis, that fell off. But it's back to 40%. Now it's back to 40%, the role of the financial sector. So we have these 17 intelligence agencies to try to control the world. And the budget of the military and the 17 intelligence agencies totals $962 billion, almost $1 trillion. How can that level of military and intelligence spending be justified for the benefit of the military, police, intelligence, industrial, and financial complex? But there's no enemy. There has to be an enemy. And a demonized enemy, or you can't spend $1 trillion a year. With regard to climate change, the number one economy in the world is pulling out of the Paris Agreement. The Trump administration strategy has been to make the United States, the world's number one producer and exporter of fossil fuels. So if we look at this realistically, that's a very bleak situation. Fortunately, there's groups in the United States that are called We're Still In, that include important states, California, which by itself is like the ninth economy in the world, Colorado, Washington, Oregon, and major cities are all supporting the goals of the Paris Agreement within We're Still In. But the fact is the federal government is not in and has a different strategy for the development of the economy of the country. The UN negotiations, the last COP25 in Madrid, failed dismally. President, Secretary General of the United Nations, Antonio Guterres, had called this the ambition cope. The high emission countries had to improve their ambition so as to be able to achieve the goal of 1.5 degrees in this century, which is absolutely vital, as the IPCC October 2018 report demonstrates. And how to do it? To get to minus 45% reduction of emissions by 2030, and reach a net zero emission society by 2050. If we do that, we can avoid the worst consequences of climate change. If we don't, we get into scenarios of 3, 4, 5, 6 degree world average, and this is world average. So it plays out differently. In the tropics, in the deserts, in the Arctic regions, it's more. And this for a tropical country like Nicaragua is absolutely critical. And that's why Nicaragua plays such a proactive role in the international negotiations, because we're very clear that climate change is one of the principal obstacles to Nicaraguan development and one of the principal challenges to humankind. I think that following the footsteps of Greta are interesting. She started out with a little strike, the lonely school striker in front of the Swedish parliament with her little sign, student strike for the climate. Didn't say anything else, student strike for climate. And then we have that she starts to meet with the world's leaders and there's great photo ops. And not much comes out of that. Then she puts her faith in the United Nations. And then she realizes in Madrid that the United Nations is not going to do it, that the COP isn't going to do it. So when she was walking out of the meeting at the UN, she said, only the people can do this. And she's right. But the people must be organized and mobilized. If we look at recent history, great fundamental social change has come out of social movements. When we really get sea tide, earthquake type of social movements. For example, the anti-slavery movement, the anti-colonialism movement, the women's suffrage movement, the labor and union rights movement. All of these movements led to basic, fundamental economic and social change. And that's what we need now. Basic, fundamental economic, social, and political change. There's no other way out. There's no other way out. And to do that, we have to overcome this hegemonic economic and social and political behemoth that is full spectrum dominance. We have to overcome that. So this means that it has to be a very profound change, and the social movement has to acquire great power to be able to do that. Now, if we look at these social movements, all of a sudden they can struggle for 100 years, they can struggle for decades, and all of a sudden it works. All of a sudden it clicks. In July 1831, the UK Parliament abolishes slavery in the empire. In 1865, after one of the bloodiest wars of the 19th century, the U.S. federal government emits the Emancipation Proclamation. By the end of the century, African slavery was gone. Was gone. How did that happen? Why did it suddenly click? I have the belief that generational change is important. That all of a sudden you reach a generation that thinks that this is an apparent evil, an obvious evil, that this is immoral, that this can no longer continue. And it's not one or two or just a few. It is the generation that has that conclusion. And it does what previous generations were not mentally equipped to do. It changes things. And I think that that's the cause for hope that we can have in the 21st century, that the struggle for survival will start to get increased force because of this new generation. Coming back from COP25 one night, we were driving through Madrid and we saw the people going home after Greta's big demonstration in Madrid, that some newspapers put it at 500,000, some put it at more, but it was huge. It was huge. So we started seeing these 17 and 18-year-olds with their placards walking home, straggling home. No way to take public transportation because there were so many people. So they were walking home. And then I started to see 10, 11, and 12-year-olds, these small kids with their placards going home. And I thought, this can be profound. This can be a generational change that really puts things over the top. Because these 16 and 17-year-olds will soon be 18-year-olds, and they'll be able to vote. And in countries that have a close correlation of forces, how they come down in the political correlation of forces could give them much greater power than one would think very early on, if they're the king makers and in this correlation of forces, if they come down very united. So I think that the days of the alienated, passive, disinterested youth are over. You're going to see a highly conscious, highly organized, highly mobilized youth struggling. And I don't think it's a fad. Some people say, oh, this is a fad, they'll get over it. I don't think they will. But it's not just idealism. It is idealism, of course. Anyone who fights for change for a lifetime is an idealist. But there's an interest involved. And they see that interest as their own future. They realize that their own future is at stake. And that gives a very solid basis and interest in their interest as an age group in the future. And you cross that with the class lines and the mass unemployment that is beckoning because of facing simultaneously the COVID-19 pandemic, the Great Depression 2020, extreme inequality like we've never seen before. Not in our lifetime will we be seeing inequality as it comes out at the end of this year. Made worse by the fact that artificial intelligence was already on the way, and the capitalists will take advantage of the fact that the workers are not there to speed up the entry of artificial intelligence. So a lot of the people who come back looking for their jobs won't find them, either because the company is no longer there and went bankrupt, or because the company has been downsized and is working with far fewer workers, or because there's a robot or a logarithm or an internet of things or 5G has replaced their job with automation. You know, the Professor Li, who was the president of Google in China and who is the guru of this artificial intelligence, estimates that 40% of jobs will be replaced by 2035. This has huge implications for the developing countries, because as developed countries move into that type of economy, even those most apt or most easily convinced to follow the developed countries won't be able to do it. Even the most reactionary governments won't be able to follow them into this type of mass unemployment. You know, this candidate Yang, who dropped out, who was the tech entrepreneur in the primaries of the Democratic Party, was proposing a universal salary. Why was he proposing a universal salary? Because he knows the mass unemployment that's going to take place. So that would be a preemptive strike against this mass unemployment and the social disruption that it will represent. Developing countries, Nicaragua, other countries can't even dream of a universal salary. We wouldn't want one either. People should earn their money working. You know, we're kind of old-fashioned, not just because they're breathing. So that would not lead to positive social life. So we're in very, very difficult times, but the survival movement is more essential than ever because of the combination of all of these different factors. The last one is artificial intelligence. And here we have the situation where scientists take very seriously the threat of artificial intelligence. That, you know, Hollywood has worked this theme very thoroughly, and it's the rebellion of the machines that and the robots that are self-replicating and self-learning, that are autonomous robots, and maybe the robot soldiers too, because the people who are into this are enthused about the electronic battlefield. You know, they have soldiers, you have robot soldiers fighting each other, that they could come to the conclusion, and this is the plot of several movies, that humans are a virus that are ruining the earth, and therefore they should be eliminated. I think that one of the reasons why scientists of the stature of Stephen Hawking and others take seriously this threat is because they haven't been able to come up with a convincing argument to put against the robot's logic. How do you debunk that logic that humans are ruining the planet when we are? So the solution, obviously, is to stop ruining the planet, to get our science and technology under control with regard to climate change, with regard to nuclear weapons, and to get a much more equal and just society as we go into this extreme inequality. And that means that we need a real revolution, a real revolution that the analysis in Equilibre is that if you can produce the necessary change within the existing structures, it is an evolution. You evolve within the existing structure. If it requires a change of the existing structure, it is a revolution. We need the survival movement to put this to the test and to start to go for the fundamental basic social transformations required. And time is running out. The time is running out in terms of the clock, the carbon clock of how much carbon we can continue to emit without exceeding the 1.5 degrees. Time is running out in terms of playing our luck with regard to the nuclear weapons. And artificial intelligence is going to speed up and is going to enter our lives in coming decades. So we need to confront all of these consequences of our science and technology.
And that's the thing that, as your book brilliantly sets out, and as you've just told us now, if it's left to capitalism, none of that is going to happen. If it's left to people who have faith in capitalism as this kind of invisible hand that Adam Smith dreamt of, this market that will regulate and control everything in the way that a god or gods used to do, then that's going to get us nowhere. But that, despite American imperialism being in an overdrive, there does seem to be sparks of consciousness in the US itself, as well as across the West, that people are starting to realize they have much more in common with movements like the Sandinistas or with the Cuban Revolution than they do with the people running their own Western societies and so on. And hopefully out of that, we'll build up something that's much more international and revolutionary and offers different ways of working, you know, towards real substantive solutions and so on.
You know, these social movements have been different people in different sectors and different countries and different continents. People in churches have always been involved in the movement. People in unions, people in political parties, people in universities, business people, students, all kinds of people from all kinds of sectors working with different methods, working with different levels of intensity, but all working for a common objective: abolish slavery. A very clear objective: abolish slavery, abolish colonialism, free the colonies. And all of that would tend to have a confluence towards that one central objective. And we need to concentrate on our survival as a species. We're very privileged to be alive. We're very privileged to participate in life. And that's our greatest responsibility as living beings to protect life, our own life and the life of our species.
Indeed. And I think, I mean, as you've indicated, most urgently we need to divest ourselves of that imperial mindset where everything could be marketized in not just mass murder, but also the, you know, extinction, the end of the planet, that somewhere on a set of algorithms, you know, finance capital will find that a positive outcome. But that's, in a sense, that's just how alienated the US's influence on the world has been, really.
You know, I don't think we can understand who we are without coming to terms with imperialism. And volume one has this history of imperialism, beginning with mercantilism. And even the mercantilism wasn't so tame as they were opening up these trading posts. You know, the Portuguese national hero Vasco da Gama, on his second trip to India, came across a ship of Muslims coming back from the Hajj to India with over 400 people on board, men, women, and children. And they begged him to, if he was going to sink the ship, to at least let the women and children off. No go, these were Moros. And this was the 15th century. And that ship was sunk, men, women, and children coming back from their religious Hajj. And the atrocities are overwhelming, really. And then we get the colonist colonialism, like in Latin America or North America or Canada, or in Australia, or in South Africa, with being a partial exception. And that is perhaps is one of the most tragic forms of colonialism, because in the other form, for example, of resource colonialism, in which the Belgians come in and literally rape the Congo and cut off the hands of people who don't comply with the king's orders, as Leopold had this, held this as private property. When they become free, entry quotation marks, when they move into the neoliberal, neo-colonial sphere, they have a sense that they've gotten their land back. They've gotten their society back. And in many countries, they do. They do get their land back. Whereas for the indigenous groups in the United States or Canada or the indigenous groups in Latin America, it's lost. And when independence comes, independence is for the invaders, not for them, for the colonists who came in. So they lose their ancestral lands and their cultures and their best societies forever. And then you get the very vehement late imperialism of the United States, Italy, Japan, Germany, who come into the game late, and they have to fight for the scraps, and it becomes what used to be acceptable is now criticized in Europe, but it's the same game. And then there's independence, which is a false independence because of neocolonialism, that the metropoles continue to exercise power over the newly independent countries. And then that morphs into a huge concentration of power in the sixth phase of imperialism, which we're living now, which is the full spectrum dominance.
Part of the problem that if the US is the world cop, it's a corrupt cop, it's a bad cop. And in addition to the kind of more straightforwardly coercive, violent way that it wields what you call the sword of Damocles in the book over the world, drone strikes, that kind of thing, there's also then the whole architecture of the global economy having to go through SWIFT and so on, and the centrality of the dollar. So that hopefully, in addition to mass movements developing new ways of thinking, alternative ways of thinking, we'll have to try and dislodge that centrality of the dollar. And I suppose, again, that's one of the reasons why China has become the new the new threat, that there's the technological advances it's made, but also then in terms of currency, that it could offer a large swathe of the world an alternative way to do business or for transactions to be undertaken.
You know, at the time of the 2007, 2008 financial crisis, the U.S. debt was about $10 trillion. And then one has the financial crisis, but also the fact that the wars are added on. The Afghanistan war, the Iraq war, the Libya war, the Syrian war. All of these wars, none of them were financed. They were all just added to the credit. They were all just, and now immediately $4 trillion was added on for measures to face the Great Depression 2020 as a result of the measures taken to confront the COVID-19 pandemic. And it's at 24 and rising. And at some point, the world is going to get tired of the United States being able to print as much money as it wants. And it doesn't affect the dollar. There's not a big dollar inflation. The US and the dollar are always seen as the safe haven for capitalism in the world. And so every time there's a crisis, there's a huge influx of capital into the United States, strengthening the United States, despite that the US abuses its seigneurage completely. But it works because the world accepts it once again, like the world is accepting the coercive unilateral illegal measures. So it's a matter, I think, of, this is a very good conversation, because I think that one, I'm beginning to understand the depth of the colonized minds. You know, a lot of people have talked about the colonized minds of the ex-colonials. We have a huge colonized mind with regard to the U.S., all of us, by accepting these abuses of the most basic human rights, accepting these abuses of the civil rights of everyone, and of the U.S. abusing economically everyone, because it is abusing everyone economically by continually devaluing the dollar in such a way that the dollar doesn't devaluate, that we just keep accepting that they can print as much money as they want.
Indeed. I mean, you know, in Nicaragua and across La Patria Grande, that this attempt to reactivate the Monroe Doctrine, it's often the Americas has been the kind of crucible for that US imperialism, things it's wanted to do and continues to do in your part of the world, it wants to do across the entire planet. I'm reminded of the great Nicaraguan poet Ruben Dario and the poem he wrote to Roosevelt, where he contrasts the sort of ideal of the US, freedom, democracy, and so on, as opposed to the reality of that invasions and tyranny and the worship of profit and greed and so on. And America, I suppose the whole existence of America has always played on these contradictions, that at times it's seen as this great progressive force. But I would have thought, whether it's the terrible things they've done in Nicaragua and will continue to try and subvert democracy in Nicaragua, the continued assault on Cuba, the fact that they've managed to subvert democracy in Bolivia, and you know, Evo Morales was kicked out supposedly because of his ecological crimes, you know, the US was somehow the guardian of indigenous people and human rights there and so on, that it's increasingly clear that that myth of America as that it's the US who will defend rights, democracy, freedom, capitalism as some sort of system of progress all across your continent, that's seen not to be the case, where they do have puppet regimes installed, whether it's big players like Brazil, but also Chile, Ecuador as well. People are on the streets fighting this. That idea that if you have an American puppet government, everything will be better, that myth has long been exposed.
Actually, you know, you're so right that people tend to not realize how active the United States has been in its attempts to dominate all of Latin America. And actually how this recitation of the Monroe Doctrine, which was already turned to dust, there weren't even bones left, it was just turned to dust. And then they tried to pull it out of this cadaver out of the historic past to say that only we and we can dominate the Western Hemisphere. And as you rightly mentioned, it's not the Western Hemisphere, it's the world. This was originally posited to the Western Hemisphere, but that was eons ago, and U.S. ambitions now are multiple aircraft carriers in the South China Sea as we speak. And all of the sanctions over Europe to try to control the economy and the commerce of Europe, like the Nord Stream. But in 2002, there was the coup against elected President Hugo Chavez, elected in as many elections as he ever ran in. And then in 2004, Jean-Bernard Aristide in Haiti is overthrown after having been elected with 91% of the vote. And there's a U.S. military intervention to escort him out of the country. In 2009, there's the coup d'etat in Honduras that the United States claimed it wasn't involved in, the State Department. But if you invest in the autobiography of Hillary Clinton, she's very effusive about her big role in it and about her discussing it with Martinelli, who wound up to be the usurper president, about putting together this coup d'etat. Then there was Lugo in Paraguay, Dilma in Brazil. And actually, you know, the Dilma thing and the Lugo thing and all of them, there's these new types of coups, which are institutional coups, in which the United States maneuvers so that all of the institutions of the state turn against the executive. Or the case of Dilma, which was absolutely ridiculous. It was over fiscal allocations and transferring money from one budget line to another budget line. which every presidency and every government in the world does. And it was just absolute pretext for that coup. And then we have the attempted coup in Nicaragua in 2018. And in Europe, it's so widespread, the fairy tale, that that was about peaceful demonstrations that were brutally repressed by the government, when we have the blockage of the highways, invasions of cities and neighborhoods, we have kidnappings, torturing, murder, arson, and we have looting, all put together bajo la consigna que se vaya ya, which is a coup d'etat consigna if there ever was one. And 24 police killed by gunshot, and 401 police wounded by gunshot. And so many people have a hard time believing in European governments, for example, that this was not a coup d'etat attempt, which goes to show how dependent they are on the U.S. Worldview and U.S. explanations, and how meekly they accept the most absurd explanations. Actually, what's the aggravating factor here is that the intellectual authors, the maximum intellectual authors of these crimes, of the crime of the Nicaraguan coup attempt, have confessed. You have President, Vice President, and Secretary of State of the United States all saying they want to overthrow the governments of Cuba, Venezuela, and Nicaragua, that they want regime change, that they want to finish off socialism in Latin America. And so the intellectual authors have confessed their participation, and still yet it's hard for these other people to take that into consideration. And then the other really embarrassing end of European self-respect, dignity, and foreign policy is the recognition of Juan Guaido as the president of Venezuela, because the United States said so. Because the United States said so. And then you have the contradictory situation where the embassy in London and Paris and Berlin continues to be of the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela, because they have to do business with the Venezuelan government. And the joker Guaido has nothing, absolutely nothing, except the resources handed over, stolen from the Venezuelan people. You know, I think that the Pirates of the Caribbean would be envious. You have Sir Francis Drake, you have Sir Walter Raleigh, you have Henry Morgan, the pirate who became governor of Jamaica. They never dreamed of 1.2 billion in bullion as their take. But the Bank of London did that. It fell upon 1.2 billion in Venezuelan gold that belonged to the Venezuelan people, and they went to give it to Guaido. And then a UK court became an accomplice to that crime by saying that that was okay with them. So we're in a very surrealistic world, but these stretches from reality are so big and so frequent that I think they need a lot of energy to keep them going. And the Guaido one is one of them, after failure to try to show that they're having less and less support, even amongst the Venezuelan opposition. Guaido is not that powerful in the opposition even. So these myths that the empire projects, it's a sad commentary when they're picked up by governments of sovereign states and they adopt them as their own.
That is part of the problem, that they will perceive themselves, and large amounts of the population of European countries will perceive themselves as liberals and progressives. But yet the reality, as you well know, is that what they're really doing is backing US imperialism that would overthrow democratic governments in your country, in Venezuela, Cuba. It would overturn free access to healthcare, to education, primary, secondary, tertiary education, and so on. So I suppose the task
for the rest of us is to support you right to the end and to make sure that we're part of that same struggle to resist US imperialism.
For me, the coercive unilateral illegal measures are a good target because they are illegal.
You know, one of the most brilliant things you've done, and it's worth saying to people that your book is also wonderfully collaborative in a way which I feel sort of typifies the Sandinista revolutionary movement anyway. It wants to encourage readers to participate and to exchange ideas with the text.
Quinibra is written in themes. Each theme has 10 statements. Each statement are 3 or 4 lines, and they're all numbered. And that is to facilitate this being a live book, a participatory process, a group community effort to inform a community that wants to support a survival movement. So if someone sees an error of fact, an analysis that could be improved, or a conclusion that needs to be tweaked or changed, they can write into the website, replacement one, and say, on 109, full spectrum dominance aspires to totalitarian control. Unipolar military, political, financial, media, communications, and cultural hegemony. Permanent warfare. So they have a contribution to that. And then in 110, we must transform ourselves, our species consciousness, and a repressive hegemonic power structure to advance and consolidate our movement for survival. They have something to say, they can send it in, and we'll have a committee. It's not like Wikipedia where it just goes straight in, because that leads to some perils and a lot of garbage also.
Yes.
So we're going to have a committee that's going to evaluate these contributions. And those that are found to be valid will have an edition of Equilibria online in the website that will be in real time updated, and we will give a footnote recognition to the people who collaborated with contributions to this living book that won't die. It will continue to live, and it can live because it can be continually updated and improved.
Mm-hmm. Oh, well, it's already really terrific, and I would encourage anybody to read it and to engage.
It's the first book written in tweets, which is supposed to correspond to the concentration lapse time of a new generation, right?
it's brilliant to dip into, but it's also very consummate and sweeping historically, philosophically, politically, economically, in what you do, and it's a real testament to your work that. Given we live in a world where the empire would just allow the human imagination to work in regard to financial speculation, your work is speculative and imaginative in all the fully human ways.
True, Aaron is going to have a section on Nicaragua. And the reason for the section on Nicaragua is that Nicaragua, by example, has a lot to teach the world.
Yes.
And I think that you have caught very well that I probably couldn't have written this if I wasn't in Nicaragua. To get into an environment where the set old analytical boxes are not what is determining thinking, discourse, action is very liberating.
Yes. That's one thing that we've tried to do in the Nicaragua Solidarity Group and the Cuba Solidarity Group and the Venezuela Solidarity Groups in Ireland, is to tell people that the usual wisdom here is that so-called liberal democracies should extend their progress elsewhere and make other countries a bit more like them, whereas for us it's the other way around, that actually the West should learn a lot more and become much more like Cuba, Nicaragua, and so on, and the kinds of things that you've done environmentally, in terms of food sovereignty, all under imperial duress, is an absolute example to the world. So thank you so much for discussing.
You know, in terms of it, just one last one, in terms of inclusion, and this is not our data. This is data from the World Economic Forum in Davos. You know, it's hard to get pure 1% capitalism than the private planes landing in Switzerland for the people to go up to Davos, right? Yes. So the World Economic Forum had Nicaragua in the gender gap index in 90th in 2007. And, you know, this is a commentary on inclusion of historically excluded people. In 2018 and 2019, the same World Economic Forum Davos Index as Nicaragua is number 5 in the world in the gender gap index. Only Iceland, Norway, Sweden, and Finland are above Nicaragua. Even Denmark is below Nicaragua for reasons I don't understand. But this means that Nicaragua is number 1 in the developing countries, number 1 in Latin America and the Caribbean, and number 1 among all of the non-Nordic countries in the world in the gender gap index. And this is an index that has economic, social, and political indicators in it.
Yes. Yeah. Absolutely terrific and inspiring. So thank you so much. It's been an inspiring chat, and to be able to listen to you and indeed to read your work. I hope to meet again, but in the meantime, saludos y solidaridad desde Irlanda.
Wonderful. Gracias. Un abrazo.
Muchas gracias.
To meeting you. I would like to get to Belfast someday. I've been to Dublin several times.
Oh,
and I was also invited to the University of Cork. And so once I flew from London to Cork and gave a conference on climate change at the University of Cork. But I've never been to Belfast, so I'm looking forward to it. I'm looking forward very much to meeting you.
That'll be wonderful. We'll take you to Belfast, and also, as Giselle will tell you if you speak to the ambassador, we'll take you to Derry as well, where there's a pub in Derry called Sandino's, which is, I think you'll enjoy. But yeah, we'll definitely.
That's Derry Sandino's. That sounds great.
Yeah. Oh yeah. So we'll definitely show you a good time if you come to Belfast and Derry.